Hello, this is David Heine, and we're here today with Lucien Lacarme, who is the project coordinator here at the Oude Kerk, the oldest church in Amsterdam. Now, this is a place that has seen as much Amsterdam history as any building. So, without anything further, maybe we can ask Lucien to give us a little summary of the early history of this building. Lucien, could you tell us a little about the history of this fascinating Oude Kerk?
Yeah, well, probably I could talk for hours about this history because it's, in fact, indeed, the probably the longest history from Amsterdam. That's because it's one of the first, or maybe the first, stone building of this city. Actually, we're sitting here on sacred ground, not only because it's a church, we're in a church, but also because here, from this point on, the city developed. From, like, say, 1260, around 1260, 1250, there was a very small church here, built here, on a grass hill with some graves, not far away, actually, from the sea. And, well, of course, the Dutch have always, through the centuries, tried to conquer the sea and put it back all the way behind the dunes, like, maybe 100 kilometers away from here. But actually, in the history time, 1260, the sea was not close from this old church. And from that time on, the church has developed in let's say 7 or 8 ages time to what it is now, and it's really a monument of significance. Well, in history, if we talk about history, of course, a lot of famous Dutch people are buried here. We have Rembrandt, who married in this church. He married with Saskia van Uylenburg, which is his first wife. And actually, Rembrandt went through this door behind me. It's called the Rode Deur, the Red Door. And he went through this door with his first wife to sign the papers for the council for his first marriage. And his first wife, Saskia, is buried in the church amongst other 10,000 people. We have 2,500 vaults, stones lying on the ground, and underneath them are mostly 4 people buried with their heads to the east. If I have to say something about the characteristics of this church, I have to mention that it always has been a church for everybody, for everyone. It's a church of the people. And it's also called the living room of Amsterdam. Why is that? Well, the living room of Amsterdam means that the doors were open to artists, but also to merchants. Actually, the first stock of the VOC, the Dutch trade company who sailed to the east, were traded, maybe even where we're sitting here now. And, well, maybe also papers which were signed were put on a behind an iron door, the first vault of Amsterdam. And I was telling something about the characteristics of this church, the living room of Amsterdam. Artists came here to do their art. There was singing, there was poetry, but also people with nothing at all. When it was raining or cold, they could stay in the church with dogs, and people were making nets or repairing things in the church. Even sometimes to shorten the way, they put at both sides of the church, they put the doors open so that people could drive through with their merchants and stuff, and even maybe sell something on the way in the church. Of course, I have to be respectful to this place because there was also religion, and before 1578 it was a Catholic religion. And what has been put up from the 13th century until that 16th century has been largely removed from the Protestants who came after this Reformation in 1578. Well, it's difficult to imagine how that place would have looked like before the Reformation, but actually, the three main topics which have remained are the stained glass windows, the ceiling, which is painted, these paintings on the ceilings, which have originated from the Catholic period. And in the choir, we have on the pillars a decoration which has remained and from the Catholic period. The Protestants, well, their idea of the religion was that it has to be very sober. So what they did with the church was to not only remove all the Catholic symbolic statues and the works of art, but also they painted the church. They painted it white. They painted it light blue. They painted it several times, the whole church, so that it would become. You would have to concentrate on what you were doing here and not looking at all the beautiful all the statues. No, you would be here to do your service. The construction of the church is that in the middle, next to the choir, we have the chapels, and all these chapels were bought by the rich merchants and their societies. So every rich merchant society bought one part of the church, and even the members of these societies, they bought their graves before they were dead. And on Sundays, they held their services, and they were different services from all of these different merchant societies. So that's why all these chapels have different names, like Sebastiaanskapel, Wijdkoperskapel, and they refer to these merchant societies. Another famous person who is buried in the old church is Zweling. He's a Dutch composer, and he has been the organ player, the main organ player of the old church for more than 44 years. He also lived on the square here behind the Oude Kerk Plaza, the square where the church is in now. Zweling, he was a composer who has made an awful lot of works. And is renowned in Holland, but also abroad. One of our famous Dutch discoverers, Van Heemskerk, he's also in the old church, buried here. And I have to tell you one thing about that, because when such a famous sea discoverer or land discoverer overseas was buried here, there was some ritual. His last armor, which he has worn in this battle, was put above the grave as a sort of honor for the deceased, and it hung there for several months. Actually, this armor of Van Heemskerk is now displayed in the Rijksmuseum. But this armor of Van Heemskerk, it was very special because one leg was missing. So you can sort of imagine how he approached his death. Well, maybe a bullet or a big, something struck his leg and it was finished, even as, the armor was gone. So you can start imagining how that would happen. Actually, we have also a painting about that Battle of Gibraltar in which he died. The old church doesn't have a rich collection like many paintings, but we have the building, which is very special to us and is also for the Amsterdam people. Although not everybody knows the church, because, well, it's in the city center here, but around the church now is the famous red light district, red light center. So if there are tourists, they mainly will visit the red light center and say, oh, that's a nice church, but they would, well, that's not totally true. Of course, a lot of tourists will visit the old church because there is a lot to see, and it's, well, not only to see but to feel, because when you visit the church, you will feel the history which has gone past this building. All the people who have been married here or who are buried here, or everything that happened here has put a little contribution to what is now here, and that's a long history. It's the total history of Amsterdam. So next to that, we have a very interesting and atmospheric light, because we have so much window space. We have about 2,000 square meters of windows. You can imagine that the sun goes past these windows. The sun rays they will give a very every minute changing atmosphere in the church. So if you walk through the church, the whole atmosphere changes almost every 10 seconds because of the light. And Well, that's very interesting. And also in our exhibitions, sometimes we give the artists, we ask them to be inspired by the place. So,
well, in the background now I hear the organ playing. This was installed originally for Swillink. Could you tell a little about the organ?
Yes, the organ, we have two organs. We have a small organ and a famous big Vater Müller organ, which is composed by or designed by Vater and Müller. They were two famous organ builders in the 18th century. Actually, Swillink, he was here before the big organ had finished. So he never played on the big organ, but the small organ. So the big organ is famous because of its sound. It's a little bit difficult to play because you have to push really hard, and it's but we use it for concerts. And after Swillink, other famous organ players have been here, and I mentioned Ton Koopman, or there are different ones. And actually, the church is also used for services on Sunday, so the building is still used as a church. And then also organs are played next to use in openings of exhibitions and other special openings or events. And yes, that's what I can tell you about the organ.
Well, now tell me a little about the architecture. How has the architecture itself changed over the years?
Well, the architecture has changed, and there are different styles combined in a church. That's also what makes it a bit specific. We have an old, very a Gothic style, but we also have, like from the Middle Ages, we have a style from the Middle Ages. And actually, if you walk through the building, through the monument, you will see that, of course, that the center from like in front of the choir is the oldest building style, and from that on you will see the style change, and that even from to the buildings, the small buildings and houses which were built around the church, they have the latest style, and they are still used for offices, or really people just live there. And yes, all that is covered by the eldest and biggest wooden, well, can I call it ceiling? Yeah, it's a sort of a, we call it tongewelve, which means in the form of a round a ton. Yeah, I don't know the English word, but so that's the oldest and highest wooden ceiling of any building or monument in Europe. Yes, that's remained intact through the ages due to the painting of the Protestant people who painted it. So when the painted was removed, these sculptures on the roof were displayed. So that's what happened then.
How is the furnishings? I noticed that there's some furnishings that looks like it's maybe from the 18th century or 19th century. That's predominantly Protestant. So how did the furbishings of the interior of the church change from the Catholic to the Reformation?
The furnishments.
The furnishments. How was that working?
We had the Beeldenstorm, which was the removal of all the Catholic symbolic religious statues and all the reliquies which were removed during that Beeldenstorm, during the Reformation. But that was a process which was not done in 1 month. It took years. So they really cared for what they were doing. They were not just breaking it down, but I would almost say kindly removed all these statues. Is that what you meant? And so the character of the church changed in several years. It was not just in 1 month. And the three main elements which were left are the stained glass windows, and some ornaments in the choir, and on the ceiling, the paintings on the ceiling.
So what did they replace it with? What did the Protestants bring in to replace what they took out?
Well, nothing. They wanted emptiness. So they wanted the church to be sober, so that all the attention would go to the surface and the religion and the praying for God, and there should not be no distraction inside the church. So of course they needed light, so they had candles hanging from the roof, and but next to that it had to be as sober as possible. And I have to mention that in the 18th century, in the choir seats, people started to make pictures, engravements. And these engravements, carvings, had very daily themes. I would say very profane themes, because that also reflected a bit the character of the church, which even after the Reformation stayed a church for the people. So the themes which you see on these engravings, the sculptures in the seats, are really daily themes, and you also are displayed people who are drinking or people who are doing wrong things. So that's a bit contradictional inside the church, but that's very interesting, I think.
Now the church itself, is it open every day, and when can the public come and visit you?
Yes, the church is open every day. On Sunday we have an opening time from 1 till 5, and during the week, and that's from Monday to Friday, and on Saturday it's from 11 till 5. So this is a summer opening time. If you visit Amsterdam and the church in the winter time, and that will mean that's up to April, and that's from October, we will have a winter opening time, which is every day from 1 till 5. So that's and you couldn't miss it. I mean, if you, it's in the old city center, and if you look outside, I mean, it's very interesting to in this area, this whole area, this old city area, attracts a lot of tourists. And I mentioned earlier on the red zone, but it's just the atmosphere of this part of town, which is still very unique, I think.
Okay, well, Lucien, thank you very much for telling us all that information about the Oude Kerk. It's truly a fascinating place.
Yes.
Thank you.